This program is made possible by the partners and friends of Bob Yandian Ministries. Coming up on this episode of Student of the Word.
It's been thousands of years and nothing has basically changed. The sky is still blue, the grass is still green, the world still looks this way, and they begin to scoff at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so because of that, many people just talk about end time events are so confusing and they don't want to hear about end time events until things begin to happen, as we've often seen around us today, where we have people in the streets and breaking of windows and we have people getting killed and we have all the things going on in front of our eyes and our peacefulness is being disturbed. And now people want to know about end times. And the point still comes is, why does Jesus wait so long?
For more than 40 years, Bob Yandian has been an expositor of the Bible, making seemingly complicated doctrine easy to understand. Grab your Bible and study the Word of God with Pastor Bob Yandian.
Good morning and welcome to Student of the Word with Pastor Bob Yandian. Once you turn your Bibles, if you would, to 1 Peter chapter 3, and while you're turning there, I want to talk to ministers today, because there's so many ministers who follow this program and who follow my ministry itself. And it's because I was a pastor for 33 years, and even the teaching ministry I had before that was to Bible school students, those preparing for the ministry before I became a pastor. I guess God just has a sense of humor. I taught pastors and never had pastored before from the Word of God. And so then after 33 years of pastoring, now I'm back to teaching ministers again and young Bible students. So I have a section on my website. It's called ministersclub.com. And you can go there. You can go directly to there, or else there's a link to it on my website. And so it's for ministers, and there's free downloads. There's sermon outlines, things like that. So I think it'd be greatly blessing for you. So again, if you're in the ministry and would like that, go there and you'll be blessed. Also, I'd like to just mention to those who are partners with this ministry, thank you so much. We've been able to expand. Things are happening great in the ministry right now. And it's because of the faithfulness of God, the faithfulness of His call on me, but also the faithfulness of those who stand with me. Partners would be, thank you so much. And again, if you're not a partner, please join me. I would be glad if you would. And because, you know, if you've been watching this for any kind of, I'm sure there's must be a link inside of you. And first of all, your partner's not in money, your partner's in heart. This is the most important thing. And you're determined inside of yourself that you'd like to see this message go even further out there. You're even recommending it to others. And other ministers probably recommend it to you, because some who actually love this broadcast and are part of this ministry are those that somebody told them about this ministry, and that they begin to like it. They begin to tell other people too. Word of mouth is how Jesus' ministry spread, and that's how greatly my ministry has spread also. But they became supporters. Jesus had a group of women that supported his ministry, a number of people, ministers that supported his disciples, others, because it took money to operate a ministry. And like, I would like to admonish you to become a part of this ministry also, so we can expand this and take it out even further. Again, thank you so much. Go to my website, bobyandian.com, and you'll find a place there where you can become a partner with me in the ministry. So 1 Peter chapter 3, I'm going to take a look at some verses of scripture here today. And we're going to take a look at verses 3 and 4, then verses 8 and 9. And here Peter says, knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last day, walking according to their own lust, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. Jump down with me to verse 8. But beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord, one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. The theme of this verse is really understanding the timing of God. And you hear it today. They said that scoffers will come in the last day. Well, they're here today. And the scoffers say the same thing. Well, he's not coming. He hadn't come. Look, it's been 6,000 years ago that Adam and Eve were placed in the garden. It's been thousands of years since the days of David, and David prophesied of this. The prophets prophesied of it. And then Jesus talked about it, and the people in the New Testament. But you know what? It's been thousands of years and nothing has basically changed. The sky is still blue. The grass is still green. The world still looks this way. And they begin to scoff at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so because of that, many people just talk about end time events are so confusing and they don't want to hear about end time events until things begin to happen, as we've often seen around us today, where we have people in the streets and breaking of windows and we have people getting killed and we have all the things going on in front of our eyes and our peacefulness is being disturbed. And now people want to know about end times. And the point still comes is, why does Jesus wait so long? Why, with all the things going on, doesn't Jesus come back now? And why doesn't God just handle all this stuff? And that's the theme of this verse of scripture. Verses 3 and 4 began it, down to verses 8 and 9, which concluded, but all the same thought. When is he ever going to come? Why is Jesus waiting so long? Why is God the Father waiting so long? That's why I'm offering the epistles of Peter on here, because this goes into description of what I'm about to discuss with you now. Then in verses 8 and 9, he says, you don't understand time from God's viewpoint. God's viewpoint is this, is that one day in heaven is 1,000 years on earth, and 1,000 years on earth is one day in heaven. You understand that in the difference in time period, and then you can understand why things don't seem so long with God as they do with us. What he's simply saying is a day with the Lord, one day in heaven, is as 1,000 years on earth. 1,000 years on earth is as one day. It's simply like time as a wheel. And what God is saying here, in heaven where I sit, time moves like this. And this is the middle of the wheel. But the outside of the wheel, when a little moves like this, it moves a lot on the outside of the wheel. He simply says one day in heaven is 1,000 years on earth. 1,000 years on earth is like one day in heaven. You stop and think about that. When did Jesus sit down at the right hand of the Father on our side? We say, well, 2,000 years ago. You know, he went to the cross, arose into heaven, and God the Father said, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. That's Psalm 110, verse 1, repeated again in Hebrews chapter 1. And Hebrews chapter 1 on into chapter 2 is the discussion of Jesus sitting down in heaven, and until the day of the tribulation comes. At the end of the tribulation, he will come back at the battle of Armageddon. But think about this. If it's been 2,000 years on earth, how long has it been in heaven? Jesus sat down at the right hand of the Father 2 days ago in heaven. So you understand the difference in how God sees things. Let's take a think for just a moment. Again, if you talk about that, I took it and took my calculator one day. If you want to pull your calculator out right there and use it, you can find it out. I simply wanted to find out what 24 hours was in heaven, and break it down to what is 1 hour in heaven. If 24 hours in heaven, which is one day, is 1,000 years on earth, then how much is 1 hour in heaven? I divided 1,000 by 24, and what I came up with is that 1 hour in heaven equals 41 years on earth. So I further broke that down. That means a quarter of an hour, 15 minutes, would be just a little over 10 years on earth, is 15 minutes in heaven. Let me give you a little idea of what that is like. My father died in 1996. And went to be with the Lord in heaven. My mom was still on this earth, and she lived for a long time. She missed him, but, you know, she lived another 22 years here on earth. She died in 2018. And so that was 22 years between the time that my dad died and my mom died. My dad was in heaven, and when he appeared in heaven, that means that just about 30 minutes later, my mother appeared standing right beside him. I'm sure he looked and said, Lucille. She said, Sam. And he said, well, good to be here. He said, listen, I just got here about 30 minutes ago, and I've been looking through the room over here, and I just completed looking at that room over there. And she said, what are you talking about? You died 22 years ago on earth. My dad must have gone, huh, I didn't know that. But that's the difference in time. Again, time is different in God's realm than it is in our realm. Think about the song, you know, Amazing Grace. When we've been there 10,000 years, we think, whoa, you know what? That's 10 days in heaven. So again, think about that. That's the difference in the time period there. Maybe it'll give you some perspective how God looks at time, how we look at time. But we're going to go beyond that, because not only does that happen and does it say that in those verses of scripture, it goes on to explain why. Why we have such time periods on earth, and why the time period is so short compared to our heaven is compared to earth is so short there. Again, when we get to heaven, it's going to be like, you know, we won't even know what time is. Basically, we'll be in heaven for so long. And the Word of God declares in Romans chapter 8, not only has God justified us, not only has God sanctified us, but he's also glorified us. You know, the time I got saved was my salvation. After that, I was justified before God, received eternal life. But God knew that before the foundation of the world. Perhaps billions of years ago. I mean, there was no angels, there was no creation, but God planned out the entire plan of creation and redemption. And so part of that was, since he knows ahead of time, God has a plan for you. He knows you're going to get saved. He doesn't make you get saved. Again, we often talk about God's sovereignty, but it has nothing to do with that. God's foreknowledge has everything to do with it. Whom the Lord did foreknow, he did predestine. So his predestined plan for me was based on his foreknowledge that I would accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. So because he knew that when I was 5 years old, I would go to an altar in a vacation Bible school and there accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, because he knew that, he planned for my redemption before the foundation of the world. But then also because he knew I would get saved, he planned for every day after that. God's got a plan for every day. I might miss it, but you know what? If I miss plan A for my life on a Tuesday and I mess up, God has plan B to get me back to plan A. God always has ways to get us back. And you say, well, what if you mess up plan B? He has plan C. What about C? Well, he has D. And you say, well, what if we get down the end of the alphabet, we get finally down to Z and I've messed up all that? God will go back to double A. I mean, God literally has more plans than you have failures in your life. And so God always has a way to get you back. But the point of it is that God has a plan for me at salvation and a plan for me after salvation, a call on my life. He has gifts of the Spirit I'm going to operate in. He has a sphere of ministry, places I will be, what church I would pastor, all these different things God knew ahead of time. And there's certain days he just revealed it to me. God does not make up what to do whenever a problem arrives. God knows ahead of time what to do. You know, when God sent Elijah to the mountain and you know, he said, I want you to go over there to the brook Cherith. It's sitting on this, it's on a mountain. So I want you to go there because I've already commanded the birds to go there and feed you, the ravens to feed you. In other words, God makes plans before he sends you. Once he sends you, the plan is already made. In other words, what he's saying was, the birds are over there and you're here. Go there and you'll find the birds. When he got up there on the mountain, he drank, but of course, because he had called for there was going to be a drought in the land that lasted 3.5 years. Well, the drought caused the stream to dry up, and it finally got down. It didn't say the stream was drying up. It said it was dry. I mean, the next thing he was going to do was reach down and get some water and basically end up putting dust in his mouth because there was no water. At that point, the Lord spoke and said, now I want you to go to Cherith because there's a widow there and I've already commanded her to take care of you. When he got there, she knew he was coming. When he got to the mountain, the birds knew he was coming. They were circling, waiting for him to get there, and they started dropping and bringing down food for him. Now, when he got to the widow's house, she was supposed to take care of him, but what we found out there was she only had a little bit of cake left. She says, I'm sorry, but I'm making this for me and my son. He said, give me just a portion of it. And of course, because of that portion in faith, what happened? She began to get the meal multiplied, the oil multiplied, and it lasted throughout the entire famine. This is what God does. But God does not always tell you ahead of time what he's going to do. He's at the time when the problem comes, he's already known the problem was going to come, already made a way of escape, and he has that plan for you. This is what God is telling us in the day we are living in. So again, when God does that, this is the beauty of it. This is God's plan for us. Now, it also says in Romans chapter 8, not only has he sanctified us, not only has he redeemed us, but says he's also glorified us. You know what glorified is? That's a resurrection body. God's also not only planned for when I get saved, after I get saved, but also when I enter eternity. He's already got a plan for me, and he already sees me a million years from now. Of course, a day with the Lord's 10 is 1,000 years, so we can break that down. It's not that many days in heaven, not that many years in heaven, but of course, if it's a million years in heaven from now, he already sees me in a resurrection body. That must mean I'm going to make it through this problem I'm going through. I must be going to make it through the next problem I'm going to go through. I must be going to make it through the next problem because God already sees me in heaven. That's how far ahead God plans. Because why? He sees it. Now, why does God take so long in his coming or in solving the problems that we see in our own country and around the world? That's the issue of this chapter, and we'll discuss it when we come back from the break. In the meantime, I want you to have a copy of this, the two epistles of Peter, 1st and 2nd Peter, describing end times, describing the times we are in, even describing scoffers that have come along to ridicule the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. I will see you after the break.
Toward the end of his life, and in the midst of the persecution and dispersal of the church in Jerusalem, the Apostle Peter wrote two letters to the scattered believers. In his epistles, Peter covered many subjects essential to the church and to individual believers. His topics include the living hope we have in the midst of persecution, the foreknowledge of God, grace in suffering, the incorruptible Word of God, your witness on the job, holiness, pastors and elders, ministering to ministers, fallen angels, the corruption of heretical teaching, and warnings against false prophets. Peter understood that the church would be dependent on the written descriptions of the truth in Christ that the apostles had left, and he provided the church with a summary of the Christian faith in the face of unbelief. In these 31 audio lessons, Pastor Bob Yandian explores the theology of the New Testament with a verse-by-verse teaching and commentary of the epistles of Peter. To order the Epistles of Peter, visit bobyandian.com. Bob Yandian Ministries is training up a new generation in the Word of God. Because of your generosity and faithfulness, this teaching ministry is able to change countless lives. You will never know until you get to heaven how many people received Jesus, were filled with the Holy Spirit, healed, or found God's will for their life through your support and prayers. If you would like to become a partner with Bob Yandian, visit our website at bobyandian.com and click on Partnership. Pastors, if you would like to schedule Bob Yandian to speak at your church, event, or conference, go to bobyandian.com/invite.
Let's go back to the verse of Scripture we're talking about. 1 Peter chapter 3, I want to read it for again, verses 3 and 4, and then jump over to verses 8 and 9. Knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. Verse 8, but beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. These are all revolving around one particular thing. Why is the Lord waiting so long to come back? Right now, we see in our own country and around the world, just our own country alone, since this bill was passed by the Supreme Court on abortion, we've had over 50 million abortions in the United States. And you look at that and go, God, how can you sit in heaven and not send Jesus back in the midst of all this? And we see all these injustices in life. We see riots and destructions and murders. All these things going on in our streets, we say, Lord, when are you going to come and settle all this? Even in the book of Revelation, martyrs during the time of the tribulation that go into heaven, their souls are under the altar. And you know what they say? When, Lord? The same cry that we hear today. When are you going to do something about this, Lord? And we see martyrs around the world. We see Christians being killed. I went to speak in the Ukraine numbers of years ago, and the pastors there, this is right after the fall of communism. In the very early 90s, I was there. My wife and I, we did a conference with Rick Renner there, and the pastors were all saying the same thing. They thought any moment that communism was going to come back and take over. They had lived under communists for so long, and they pointed to fields out there. They said, there are thousands and thousands of Christians and ministers out there that communism came in and killed. They said, our father's bones are in there, our grandfather's bones are in there. We don't know where. We just know they just literally ripped open fields and put bodies in there and covered it back up. And they said, that's out there. They said, and they listen, they lived each day as if the communists would come back in and take over again. That's the type of fear they lived under. But the main thing they kept saying is, when is Jesus going to come back? We see so much sexual trafficking today, human trafficking of young girls and young boys being around the world, being taken in to these things. And it's growing so huge and becoming a major industry of trafficking children for sexual abuse. But the point of it is, we wonder, Lord, when are you going to come? I know of a young woman that works in California for a place where the girls are brought in and they're actually kidnapped out of trafficking to brought to this place where they can understand the things of God. They can be adopted by parents and stuff like that to take them. But often these young girls, even in their late teens, they just have no personality because all they've been is abused from the time they were tiny children. And one woman told, she said, I was sold into trafficking by my brother. She said, my brother actually took me and sold me into another girl, said, my dad sold me. I mean, all his friends would come over and she said, he would let me be used by them for having sex. And then finally one day just needed some money. So he sold me to one of them. And she said, this has been my life. And the one woman that was part of our church that was taking care of him said, you have no idea. These women have no personalities. They have no desire to live or anything. And they're waiting for any moment for their pimp to call them back and say, I love you. And they'll try everything they can to run. They're looking for someone that can love them. We see all that going on. And our first thought is, Lord, when are you going to come? I mean, our voice joins in with the martyrs under the altar. Our voices join in with the riots and destructions that are going on today and Christians crying out, Jesus, when are you going to come back? We read the end of the book, but why are you doing that? It's for one reason. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Even with all these things going on in the earth today, which has gone on before in the time of Rome, in the time of the early days of the nation of Israel with Egypt and all this, and we find it throughout the world. This has been going on for centuries. And the cry must have been coming up for some 6,000 years into the ears of God himself. And the people are saying, when, Lord, are you going to come back? And he says this, I'm not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Why does God wait another day? Because he waits every day because someone could receive him as Lord and Savior. It all comes back to this. Every day is one more day for someone to be saved. Think of the Battle of Armageddon when it finally comes. There's going to come a day, and we can see it happening around us. The Bible predicted this day, prophesied of this day, told us it was coming, when there's going to be international communism around the world. There's going to be a one world government set up, and all mankind will be in slavery to the elites that run this particular world. And they're going to confiscate all of our money and then just distribute little of it just to keep us alive in this earth. And there's going to come a day when the Bible says a loaf of bread will cost a penny. A penny was a day's wage. Can you imagine an entire day's wage could only buy you one loaf of bread? That's going to come during the time of the tribulation. We're going to see widespread abuse and killings and murders and all this in religion, one world religion. And the woman that's sitting on the back of the beast has a cup in her hand, and there's blood in the cup. It's the blood of the martyrs. They kill so many people in the name of one world religion. All this is so that Satan can have control of this world, because what he's trying to do is to imitate God himself. He's tried his best to overthrow God. He's tried his best to literally come up and take over God's throne. He's been cast out and to the earth beneath. And in the Bible even tells what's going to happen, but Satan doesn't believe it. He still is trying to overthrow God. And so he knows that Jesus Christ is going to rule and reign in this earth. He knows that Jesus Christ, by reading the scriptures, he's going to rule and reign from Jerusalem. So Satan has decided to counterfeit that and try to do it himself. Satan sees himself as the God of this world, and therefore as God, he's got to have a Messiah. So there's going to come an offspring between Satan and a woman, and this is called Antichrist. Antichrist will sit on the throne in Jerusalem, in the temple, in the place where Jesus Christ is supposed to sit, and Satan's going to try to destroy Israel, destroy Jerusalem, so that there will be no place for Jesus Christ to come back. If he can do that, then the Bible is a lie. It did not happen, and Satan can take over. All the tribulation is Satan trying to establish his own millennial reign of him ruling over the earth and his Antichrist ruling from the throne. But at the end of that, Jesus Christ is going to come back and destroy all that. Again, we come to that. How is that going to happen? We see it inching toward that, and we're closer than ever with all the things we see around us. In fact, they've already begun to predict time that this is going to happen. UN, other organizations working around the world are all headed toward a time down the road when they're going to take over, have even given the time period of year when they see it happening. I'm not going to give it to you, but the point of it is they've predicted this before. It's always been pushed away, much like global warming to destroy us in 15 years after 15 years comes. Well, it's going to be another 30 years. Then it's 50 years down from that. The world won't be here anymore. All the different things they say, and the world is still here because the earth will exist from now on. And so again, but we have that coming, and all these things are predicted coming, but it's going to come to pass one day. Just before the tribulation begins, the church will be removed and taken into heaven to go through the judgment seat of Christ. And then 7 years of tribulation are going to come. And you know what the cry is going to be during the tribulation? When are you going to come and stop all this? When? And God still comes back to this point that I'm bringing out here in the book of 1 Peter. And that is the fact he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Armageddon will happen at the last possible moment. This is told in the book of Joel. In the book of Joel, just before Jesus Christ comes back, it's called the Valley of Jehoshaphat, the Valley of Decision. In the 7 years of tribulation, we come down to God knows the exact day it's going to happen. He even tells us how many days. We say, well, I thought the Bible says we don't know the day or the hour. We don't know the day or the hour of the second coming of Jesus Christ because we don't know the day or the hour of the rapture. But once the rapture occurs, the book of Revelation describes it in the exact number of days it's going to happen. It gives the exact number of days of the first half of the tribulation and the exact number of days of the second half of the tribulation, and tells believers in Jerusalem and in Judea, in the area of Israel, on what to do, where to flee whenever they see Antichrist set up his throne in the temple itself, because the second half of the tribulation is called the Great Tribulation. You think the first half was bad, the second half is worse. In fact, Jesus said of the second half of the tribulation, there has never been such a bad time, no, never was nor ever shall be as bad a time in all of history as the second half of the tribulation. And people are crying out. Martyrs are coming into heaven, being killed, crying under the altar. When are you going to stop this? When are you going to stop this? And finally, when God's going to stop it will be one day before the end of the tribulation. And in one day, the day before that, 2 days before the end of the tribulation, on that one day, Antichrist and all the armies of the earth are going to come in and overtake Jerusalem and conquer half of the city. And the next day, they're ready to take over the second half of the city. They all go to bed that night, and when they wake up the next morning, it's pitch black. There's darkness covering the face of the earth. And again, the book of Joel describes this and calls the Valley of Jehoshaphat. And the name for Jehoshaphat is the Valley of Decision. God is going to give the earth one more day, 24 hours, to accept him as Lord and Savior. Why? Because he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Abortions, riots, destruction, murders, martyrs under the altar, human trafficking, all the things I mentioned, God still hasn't sent Jesus Christ. Why? Because even out of all that evil that's going on, somebody's going to receive Jesus as Lord and Savior, and that's why Jesus came to the earth, and that's what our message is. I hate all this stuff that's going on. My heart goes out to these things that are going on. I think of babies that have been aborted. But here's the point. On the other side of this, there's good. God even gets good out of the horrible things that mankind does. And that is when a baby is killed, even in the womb, it goes to heaven. David's baby that died in the Old Testament, even when that child died, and he cried and he prayed for that child to live, but the child died. It was only about a week old. When it died, David rose up and said, I will go to be with that child, but that child shall not return to me. He even knew back then that a child in innocence before the age of accountability, if they die, they go to be directly with the Lord and the Lord will raise them in heaven. All those children that have been aborted, we will see them when we get to heaven. God will raise them. And I can tell you this, he will do a better job than even the parents could have done. Yes, it had been best if they could stay in this earth, but no matter how evil man can be, God can turn it around. Supernatural darkness will cover over this earth for the space of 24 hours to give everybody one more chance to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And when that light lifts, then it's too late to receive Jesus. And it's again one day before the destruction of Jerusalem, 24 final hours to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. It's a supernatural darkness that only supernatural light will penetrate. It's the same type of darkness that covered the earth when Jesus was on the cross. You can turn on lights, you can turn on searchlights, nothing can be seen, but Jesus will come back at the end of that 24 hours as lightning from the east to the west. Supernatural light will penetrate supernatural darkness, and the world will see him. At that point, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess, all governments will have to admit Jesus Christ is Lord, but it will be too late because you cannot accept Jesus Christ after that darkness is gone. What's it all come back to? He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Your day today is another opportunity to tell somebody that Jesus Christ is Lord, died for them. No matter what evil is going on in the earth, Jesus Christ is alive and well and wanting to save anyone who will believe in him. See you tomorrow.
You can order resources, become a partner, or browse free articles and podcasts by visiting our website at bobyandian.com. You can also join our mailing list and receive weekly devotions and the latest ministry updates. If you would like to contact Bob Yandian Ministries, visit bobyandian.com and click on Contact. To contact us by mail, use the address on your screen. Thank you for watching today's broadcast. We'll see you next time on Student of the Word with Bob Yandian.